This is the third of the three lectures about the geographic grid. We now finish this up with another point of longitude. You know that the equator is at 0 degrees latitude. I told you that 90 degrees north is the North Pole, 90 degrees south is the South Pole. You now know that the prime meridian is 0 degrees longitude. So what is at 180 degrees east and 180 degrees west? Well, first of all, they are the same place. If you start at the prime meridian and you move into the eastern hemisphere, because the prime meridian is zero and because this is a system of counting, you begin to count 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Eventually, you go halfway around the world, a hemisphere away, and you reach 180 degrees east. If somebody else was at the prime meridian and they began to do the same thing into the western hemisphere, they would begin to count also 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Eventually, they would get halfway around the world and they would be at 180 degrees west. These two places are the same place. 180 degrees east and 180 degrees west are both on the opposite sides of the planet from the prime meridian. Let's take a look. At 180 degrees east and west, kind of, is the international dateline. If you look at this map, you can see the red arrows are pointing at the international dateline. Out in the middle of the Pacific, it follows exactly along 180 degrees east or west, halfway around the world from the prime meridian. But notice up in the north, it makes a little bend around Siberia, and it makes another bend south of that around the Aleutian Islands. This is to keep these countries essentially in the same day. And then if you look down to the south, you can see that it makes another bend going around some island groups. That's okay. We are going to operate under the assumption that the international dateline is at 180 degrees east and west to make things easy for all of us. How does it work? Well, it works like this. Let's take a flight together. Who knew that we were going to take a flight in this class? But we're going to take a flight in this class. We're going to fly from LAX, Los Angeles International Airport in Los Angeles, California, to Beijing, which you can see is plotted out there. There's LAX on the right-hand side at A. There's Beijing on the left-hand side at B. And if you look carefully, you can see that there's an arcing green line. That's going to be the route that we are going to fly. Let's assume some things. Let's assume that we depart LAX on a Tuesday and we are headed west. Yes, we are headed more or less in a westerly direction. Because if you were at the prime meridian and you went to Los Angeles, you now know that Los Angeles has a designation of 34 degrees north, 118 degrees west. So you traveled 118 degrees of longitude from the prime meridian to get to Los Angeles into the Western Hemisphere. If we continue off to Beijing, we have to continue in a westerly direction. So from 118 to 119 to 120 and so on like that. As we're heading along, we're flying and we're headed basically west across the Pacific Ocean. As we do that, let's assume that we reach the international dateline at 11 a.m. So it's Tuesday at 11 a.m. What is going to happen as we cross the international dateline? First, I want you to know this. As you cross the international dateline, the time remains the same. So it will remain 11 a.m. However, you add 24 hours when you're headed west, and Tuesday at 11 a.m. instantaneously, that was my finger snapping, it becomes Wednesday at 11 a.m. Just like that. It's like if you're listening to this lecture and it's Thursday at 6 p.m., it would be like, just like that, it's suddenly Friday at 6 p.m. So we land in Beijing. We have a good time over there in China, as much as that's possible, as long as we keep our mouths shut about things. I guess it will be okay. And then what happens is this. We're going to get on a flight and we're going to fly home. So we're going to fly from Beijing to Los Angeles, to LAX, and you can see the route there. This, by the way, is a real route. I pulled it off the internet of a route going from LA to Beijing. Okay, and let's assume this. Let's assume that we depart on a Sunday from Beijing going to Los Angeles. Now we're headed east, and let's assume that we reach the international dateline at 2 p.m. So we're headed east. It's Sunday at 2 p.m. We're going to cross the international dateline. Once again, the time remains the same. So it will stay 2 p.m. But what are we going to do with the day? We subtract 24 hours and it suddenly becomes Saturday at 2 p.m. That would be, if it's Thursday at 6 p.m. and you're listening to me right now, that would mean suddenly it's Wednesday at 6 p.m. That's correct. So you subtract 24 hours in that flight when you cross the international dateline headed east. Very good. Take a look. Do you see this route that we're flying on? Why does the route look like this with this arc? Why doesn't it do that? What appears to be straight away? Remember, airlines are in the business of making money. They want to fly the quickest, shortest route that they can possibly go, use the least amount of fuel, load the plane up, and get people going again. Therefore, they are always going to, as much as it's possible, take the shortest possible route. Well, the Earth is round. And flat maps do not reflect that spherical object. As a result of that, flat maps are distorted when they're attempting to represent something as large as the entire planet. Typically, what will happen is along the northern hemisphere, up towards the higher latitudes, things will be stretched out. This is a reason when you were a kid, you may very well have looked at Greenland and thought, well, how come Greenland isn't a continent, but South America is? Well, South America is significantly bigger than Greenland if you look at a globe. And in the southern hemisphere, the same thing happens. When you get to the higher latitudes of the southern hemisphere, everything is distorted. Along the equator, typically, it's okay with the flat map. What happens is, with aviation and oceanic shipping, the route that is typically taken is called a great circle. A great circle is the shortest distance between any two places on Earth, or any sphere, any ball for that matter. And a great circle always splits the Earth into two equal halves, as you can see in that diagram. That's a great circle, which means the equator operates as a great circle. If you're at the equator and you're going to take the shortest distance to any other place on the equator, that shortest way to pull that off is going to be stay at the equator and move along. Take a look back so you can see that here's this arcing route we take, which means this: if we had some magic plane and we could take off from Los Angeles and land at Los Angeles after going all the way around the planet with the shortest route, what would eventually happen when we landed at LA is we would have split the Earth exactly in half like that.